New Society Publishers presents Essential Green Roof Construction, The Complete Step-by-Step Guide by Leslie Doyle, narrated by Victoria Verzosa. Acknowledgements. To my mom and dad, your words and lessons will never be forgotten. A big thank you to Chris Magwood for teaching me how to look at buildings through a sustainable lens. Thank you for encouraging me to write this book and for your thoughtful edits and contributions. Thank you to the New Society team for the opportunity and making the book better than I could have ever imagined. Thank you to all the past Restoration Gardens staff. Kira White, Steve Massey, Sarah Raffles, Anna King, David King, Grayson Sherritt, Yolanda Lloyd, Jesse John, and Katie Howard. For your ideas, heavy lifting, and research on all our wonderful projects, and for capturing them so beautifully in the pictures used throughout these pages. Please see the downloadable PDF for these pictures. Thank you to Femke Bergsma of Graham, Arlene Thronis, Jane Miles, and Jessica Russell at Ryerson University, and Marc Boucher-Colbert of Urban AG Solutions for taking the time during these challenging days to educate me about edible roof gardens. Thanks go to all of the following. To my friends and family who generously offered quiet spaces, family support, and active listening. To Lorna for raising my children throughout this journey. To my children, Sullivan and Francis, for the renewed inspiration. And to my husband, Jackson, for his endless motivation and patience. Chapter 1. Introduction to Green Roofs. Our roofs, which keep us safe and dry, are subject to a range of environmental stresses. They are exposed to substantial rains and damaging hail, destructive heat and UV radiation, strong winds and heavy snow. Our changing seasons and associated temperatures can wreak havoc on the waterproof membrane material used on many roofs, causing it to expand, contract, dry, crack, and then leak or break down. Investing in a quality roofing membrane gives homeowners peace of mind in keeping their house protected. But why not go further? Why not utilize the roof space as a means to contribute to the biodiversity in your neighborhood and offer a protective place for pollinators or birds to feed? Why not reduce the impact of the space by reducing the heat it would normally reflect, or capturing the rain that would run off of it? Why not do all these things? Why not make your roof do more? You can. You can build a green roof. Green roofs, eco roofs, vegetative roofs, vegetated roof assemblies, or living roofs, regardless of the name, they are all roof systems designed to support plant life. Green roofs provide a range of benefits for your site and your community, and they are an opportunity to turn a static surface into a buzzing tapestry of color. Green roof systems. While some green roofs can be complex, others can be quite simple in design. Regardless of your design, for a green roof to succeed, it must include the following 5 main elements. A strong roof structure, a waterproof membrane, suitable growing media, good drainage, appropriate plants. Understanding how these elements come together will allow you to design and build the green roof you need. Throughout this book, I will provide you with visual examples to guide you. You can build a green roof layer by layer, a built-in place, BIP, system. Or you can install manufactured products, such as trays that come pre-fitted with all the needed layers, often including pre-grown vegetation. You can also create hybrid systems. For example, layers can be installed on the roof with a pre-grown vegetation mat unrolled over top, or you can install modules pre-filled with media and complete the planting on the roof. Green roof categories. Green roofs fall into three categories: extensive, intensive, or semi-intensive. Extensive systems have shallow planting, making them inhospitable to many species. This means they support less plant diversity. However, they require less maintenance and upfront cost. These are the types of roofs most people think of when they think green roof. Intensive systems have few restrictions and can be designed as accessible public parks with soil depths deep enough to support trees. The middle ground of a semi-intensive roof typically allows for greater plant diversity than an extensive roof, and therefore requires a little more maintenance, but they are not as resource-heavy as intensive roofs. See the downloadable PDF for images of each kind. This book is focused on extensive roofs and semi-intensive roofs, but it also introduces food production roofs. Food roofs, rooftop farms, and edible roofs are all terms referring to green roofs that are built or modified for the production of food. These are often considered semi-intensive or intensive roofs due to the depth of the growing media and the frequency of maintenance that is required. See the downloadable PDF to see a food roof in an urban setting. Extensive, semi-intensive, and small food roofs can easily be built and managed by an enthusiastic and competent DIYer on simple residential or outbuilding rooftops. Intensive roofs should be left to professional contractors, as they require an integrated approach with input from architects, engineers, landscape architects, and material suppliers. The following table highlights comparisons between the three types of green roofs this book will cover. Figure 1.5. Comparisons of green roof categories and system types. Depth of growing media. Extensive, less than 6 inches. The ideal minimum is 4 inches. Systems with less than 4 inches of growing media tend to require permanent irrigation systems and provide fewer ecosystem services. Systems with shallow growing media are most appropriate for existing roofs with restricted weight loads. Depth of growing media. Semi-intensive, approximately 4 to 8 inches. Food production roof, varying depths of 6 to 12 inches or higher. Type of growing media. Extensive, traditionally aggregate-based with low percentage of organics. Semi-intensive, typically involves a higher organic content. Food production roof can be as much as 100% organic. Typical plants. Extensive, moss, sedums, some grasses, some flowering perennials. Semi-intensive, grasses, flowering perennials, some bulbs, some shrubs. Food production roof, fruits, vegetables, and herbs. Irrigation needs after establishment. Extensive, low. Semi-intensive, moderate. Depends on soil composition and climate. Food production roof, high. Modular systems available. Extensive, yes. Semi-intensive, yes. Food production roof, can use some modular components, but do planting yourself. Saturated weight. Ranges are based on commercially available blends. Custom soil blends could be higher. Extensive. 4-inch systems are approximately 20 to 30 PSF. Semi-intensive. 30 to 60 PSF. Food production roof. 50 to 100 PSF, depending on the depth of soil over 6 inches. Cost. Total costs typically escalate as the growing media deepens. On a square foot basis, the cost per square foot will go down the larger the roof gets. For a DIY install, where labor is typically free, you will have to do your own cost comparison for materials to compare modular and BIP systems. Extensive, low. Semi-intensive, moderate. Food production roof, most expensive in terms of ongoing resource and maintenance needs. Maintenance, extensive, lowest. Semi-intensive, moderate. Food production roof, high. New builds versus retrofits. Green roofs can be built on both new and existing roofs. On new roofs, you have the freedom to build the roof structure based on your green roof design intent, whereas on an existing roof, your green roof may not exceed the existing structural capacity. If your existing roof does not allow for the added weight of a green roof, you can retrofit your roof to accommodate your loading needs. However, this can be a costly venture. This book will give you everything you need to know about building a green roof, but it does not directly show you how to design or build the roof structure underneath it. The typical green roof assembly does not include the roof structure itself. However, these two building components are highly interdependent. Reviews of local codes and/or a call to a structural engineer are necessary to ensure your structure is adequate for the amount of additional loading you intend to add. How this book can help you. The green roof industry is still relatively young and therefore still evolving. In North America, awareness and interest in green roofs has exponentially increased in the past decade and a half, and there is a growing body of research and publications. Whereas the early research was concerned with how the newly developed systems from Germany could be of use to our cities, research is now more focused on region-specific systems and designs for specific ecosystem services. 20 years ago, the only books published on green roofs were intended to educate contractors on this new type of construction. Now, many books are published, filled with award-winning designs of green roofs around the world. In addition, the industry is still learning many valuable lessons and developing products specifically for green roofs. As awareness and interest increase, many individuals are left wondering how they might build their own simple system. Referencing lessons from these valuable resources, as well as my experience in building green roofs for the past 10 years, this book aims to provide the necessary information and planning steps for the do-it-yourself builder. The lessons in this book are for homeowners building simple green roof projects. They are not intended to be applied to complex installations or used by commercial installers, who must strictly adhere to municipal building and safety codes and may have to follow manufacturer recommendations for warranty purposes. My goal for this book was to use common language that would not require a horticulture or construction background. However, I want you to be familiar with the key terms so you feel competent when ordering supplies or talking to professionals. In addition to terminology, you will find planning steps, installation and design considerations, plant and material choices, two installation examples, maintenance considerations, and an introduction to food production roofs. Consideration is given to the diversity of North American climates. Many details are provided so that regardless of the size of your build, you will have all the necessary planning preparation in front of you. However, if you are merely building a small green roof over a tool shed or a dog shed, in no way am I diminishing Spot's need for well-being. You may not need to consider all the steps found in chapters 3 and 4. They are still worth a read, however, so you can make informed decisions down the road. Attention to details. Racing through details can cause big problems, especially when you are dealing with water over top of your home. Do not underestimate the ability of water to find small imperfections. In this book, you will find very detailed drawings illustrating the concepts. Please review these carefully and apply the same level of detailed attention to any new ideas or variations you may wish to perform. For these drawings, see the downloadable PDF. Chapter 2: Green Roof Layers and Roofing Terminology. Green roof layers. A green roof incorporates a series of layers that work together to protect the building underneath it from water while supporting plant life. These layers are divided into two categories. 1. Those that are required to ensure the green roof will function properly, and 2. Those that are optional based on the design specifics. Descriptions of these layers are found in this chapter. And in Chapter 7, you will find material specifications. Required layers. Waterproof membrane. The most essential part of any green roof, a waterproof membrane keeps water out of the structure, protecting the integrity of the building. This layer usually lies directly on top of the building's roof deck. Root barrier. A root barrier protects the membrane from root penetration. Some roots are quite aggressive and can cause damage if allowed to grow without restrictions. This layer is an absolute requirement if the membrane does not contain root-resistant properties. Drainage. Layers and outlets. The drainage layer allows water to flow freely through the built assembly and toward the drain outlets. Drainage outlets allow water to run off the roof. Both drainage elements, down and out, are required to eliminate standing water, especially on flat roofs. Filter cloth, also known as geotextile. Filter cloth is required to keep the fine particles of the growing media out of the drainage layer, ensuring that the drainage layer does not become clogged, which would restrict the movement of water. See the downloadable PDF for Figure 2.3, an illustration of a drainage system. Growing media. Growing media is a substrate in which the plants grow. As opposed to most gardening soils, media on a green roof is typically a mix of organic material and lightweight aggregate. Plants. Plants are the last thing to go on the green roof. They serve as visual indications of how well you have built the assembly and the health of your system. Optional layers. In addition to the required layers of a green roof, there are optional layers. The necessity of these items will be based on your green roof design. Membrane protection. This layer protects the membrane from continuous friction or pressure points coming from the overlying layers. Membrane protection is normally required for intensive systems because they are heavier and more prone to foot traffic. The need for membrane protection in extensive systems depends on your membrane type and the overlying drainage layer. Insulation. Insulation in a green roof is typically in the form of rigid boards. In flat roofs, insulation can be part of the underlying roof structure as the primary thermal barrier, or it can be added on top of the roof structure, where it can act either as a primary thermal barrier or as an enhancement to the thermal performance of insulation that already exists in the ceiling. Water retention. A water retention layer temporarily holds water in between rain events. A water retention barrier may be required for roofs with steep slopes in areas with high winds or for roofs with very shallow depths, i.e., 2 inches or less. Slope restraints. On steep green roofs, a manufactured or built-on-site restraint system must be incorporated to prevent growing media from sliding. Wind erosion protection. This type of protection is a temporary or permanent mechanism or design feature intended to prevent wind from blowing the growing media off the roof. Irrigation. It may be necessary to provide a temporary or permanent source of supplementary water to plants in between rain events. Roof terminology. Gable roof. A roof with two sides that meet at a ridge. Shed roof. A simple roof with one slope. This is probably the best type for a DIYer to work with the first time. Roof deck. The roof deck is a construction material that sits between the structural supports, joists or trusses, and the waterproofing material, membrane. In residential applications, it usually consists of plywood or tongue-and-groove lumber. Parapet. A parapet is a small wall that runs along the perimeter of the roof deck. In a green roof application, the parapet works to keep the green roof material contained on the roof, as well as aid in wind erosion protection. It can be made of stacked or formed lumber sitting on top of the roof deck, or it can be made of stacked stone. It can also be a continuation of the exterior wall. Cant strip. A triangular strip placed in the angle between a roof and a parapet or any other vertical surface to which the roof abuts, including building walls. This strip provides support behind membranes in areas where sharp corners may be hard to achieve. Cant strips can be made of concrete, wood, steel, insulation, or insulation composites. Scupper. A scupper is an opening in the parapet where water exits. It is usually at the lowest point of the slope, and more than one may be necessary based on the slope, design, or size of the roof. Emergency overflow. An emergency overflow is a fail-safe way to ensure that water can escape from the roof in the event of a clogged scupper. In a situation where the parapets are high, a clogged scupper would result in excess water pooling, potentially exceeding the weight allowance for the structure. Cricket. A cricket is a high point designed into the roof deck to divert water. They are often used around building structures, such as chimneys, and at transitions from one roof section to another. They are also used on roofs where one slope may not clear all the water off the roof. See the downloadable PDF for a diagram of Figure 2.4. A. Parapet. B. Roof deck. C. Cant strip. D. Membrane. Drip edge. A drip edge is a metal flashing used to force the water off the lower edge of the roof instead of allowing it to trail back toward the house. It is also the term used for the lower edge of the roof where water drains off. Rake edge. The rake edge runs along the roof from the lowest point to the highest point. Water typically does not flow off these edges. See the downloadable PDF for Figure 2.6. Basic roof components on a typical flat roof with parapets. Eaves. Eaves are the section of the roof that overhangs from the wall out to the end of the joist. The job of the eaves is to protect the walls from water coming off the roof and/or from rain. Gutter, eaves trough. Gutters, as they are known in the U.S., or eaves trough, as they are known in Canada, are channels that are fastened to the fascia board at the drip edge. Gutters collect water and direct it down a downpipe or rain chain, away from the foundation of the house. Now that you have a basic understanding of a green roof system and the parts of a roof, we can go through how to build one. See the downloadable PDF for Figure 2.7, Basic Roof Components on a Typical Shed Roof with No Parapets. Chapter 3. Before you start. There are many reasons why homeowners choose to build a green roof. Besides the unrivaled beauty they offer over traditional flat roofs, green roofs serve many purposes on a small scale, such as increased thermal and sound insulation, reduced site runoff, increased amenity spaces, and an increased membrane lifespan. Although most green roofs can serve multiple purposes quite easily, it is important for you to be clear about what your specific goals are for your roof. Figure 3.2 outlines some design goals with corresponding considerations. Common design goals and considerations for homeowners. Design goals. Aesthetic-based. Improve the view. Considerations. Minimal loading, extensive system. Focus on lightweight products and low-maintenance plantings. Aesthetic-based, increase biodiversity. Considerations. Higher loading, semi-intensive system. Increase planting depth and organic content of growing media. Some species require more water, so consider water retention layers to avoid having to irrigate. Design goals, function-based. Reduce stormwater runoff. Considerations. Higher loading, semi-intensive system. Growing media components should be chosen based on water retention capabilities. Consider moisture retention mats and plants which have higher rates of transpiration. Design goals, function-based. Increase insulation value of the roof. Considerations. Extensive or semi-intensive systems. Add suitable insulation for system components. Include some growing media components that keep the roof cooler, i.e., vermiculite, and plants that offer more shading of the surface. Design goals. Function-based. Produce food. Considerations. Higher loading. Semi-intensive system. Increase water retention and/or irrigation. Increase organic content. Be aware of increased safety and access needs. Other design goals. Low-maintenance roof. Or lightweight green roof. Considerations. Minimal loading extensive system. Use shallow inorganic substrates to support mainly succulent species. Other design goals. Green roof in the subtropics. Considerations. Extensive or semi-intensive systems. Growing media should balance drainage with water retention to handle seasonal flooding and periods of drought. Incorporate vermiculite to retain water but reduce growing media heat transfer during the summer. Choose plants adapted to regional stressors that can provide some canopy shading. Other design goals. Green roof with a low carbon footprint. Considerations. Extensive or semi-intensive system. Minimal loading to reduce underlying joist size. Focus on local and/or recycled materials or choose materials that can be recycled at end of life. Choose soils with higher levels of organics, which could include biochar and/or compost. Plan for diverse, competitive, drought and stress-tolerant plantings that produce more biomass than succulents for increased CO2 absorption. While many people get excited over the type of green roof they want to build, The first step will be to establish if it's possible. Start with these steps. Check with your local municipality for any regulatory requirements. Check if your insurance policy coverage will need to change. Have a structural engineer determine if your roof can handle the extra loading. If you are building a new structure, you have greater flexibility, as you can build the roof to handle the extra loading required. Codes and standards. Standards for the construction of a green roof assembly are not yet typically part of building codes. However, the membrane and any roofing insulation you include will have to adhere to local code regulations as it relates to the roof structure. Before starting your green roof planning, review your municipal bylaws or regulations. This will determine if your municipality requires the construction of the green roof to follow a set of standards or guidelines, as mentioned above, and will determine if you qualify for any local incentives. Appendix A gives a list of some common standards and guidelines that may have been adopted by your local municipality. Appendix B provides a list of North American cities that have green roof programs in place as of early 2021. For example, in Toronto, there is a bylaw that requires and governs the construction of green roofs on buildings over 21,500 square feet, 2,000 square meters, in gross floor area. While this does not include home projects, the City of Toronto does require permits for all green roofs in the city and requires that they conform to the Toronto Green Roof Construction Standard. The city provides a supplementary guideline with illustrations offering best practices for achieving the standard. For those who voluntarily build a green roof, the city offers a financial incentive for both the initial structural assessment and the installation. The city also offers great guidelines for creating green roofs that build habitat and promote biodiversity. Be sure to read standards and guidelines carefully. Some may require a designated green roof professional, GRP, or other registered design professional to submit the applications, provide drawings, or build the roof. Take special note that grants usually require you to start the process of application prior to starting construction. Even if your jurisdiction doesn't have regulations or a set of construction standards, you will still want to know about the topics covered in this chapter. For a simple green roof built by a homeowner, it is important to understand how a green roof system works, the role of each layer, how to choose appropriate materials, and what is necessary to maintain the integrity of the structure and waterproof membrane. Insurance. Some home insurance policies may change based on the addition of a green roof. Be prepared to present your insurer with your intended risk mitigation strategies, such as adequate structural design, roof details, fire prevention, and maintenance. With the escalating costs associated with flood damage in many cities, insurance companies are starting to welcome low-impact design solutions. Structural loading capacity. Structural loading capacity is one factor that determines whether or not a green roof is possible. There are two loads to consider when planning a green roof. Dead load. The weight allowance for all permanently placed material. This includes the roof structure and the green roof assembly, including plants and the weight of the amount of water required to saturate the growing media, in addition to any hardscaping or permanent fixtures. Live load. The weight allowance for all temporary material. This includes weights imposed by weather such as wind, rain, and snow, as well as temporary items such as equipment or people. Live load allowances vary by region. You should have full confidence that your roof is built to meet or exceed all weight load requirements. If you are doing new construction, design your walls and roofs with sufficient strength and stiffness to support your desired green roof. I always recommend overbuilding your structure to leave you with some flexibility, should you need it. Always refer to span tables in your local building codes. Weight loads are provided in pressure conversions. In this book, I will be using pounds per square foot, PSF. See the downloadable PDF for figure 3.3 for a list of common weight allowances found on roofs and the corresponding class of green roof allowed. For existing roofs, you can assume that your roof meets the minimum regional requirements, but you will require a structural engineer or other registered design professional to let you know what dead load capacity, if any, is available for the addition of a green roof. If you are provided with a low weight value, about 15 pounds per square foot, from an engineer, you can still create a green roof, but you will be limited in the depth of media and therefore the plants you are able to grow. Those who currently have a flat roof with gravel ballast are likely able to replace the ballast with a very light green roof system, as ballast roofs typically weigh 10 to 15 pounds per square foot, 48.8 to 73.2 kilograms per square meter. However, this should be confirmed first. A structural engineer can look at existing permit drawings, or they can inspect the roof to determine the joist size and spans for their calculations. When you calculate weights of materials, you must consider saturated loads, as most materials are designed to absorb water. A product that retains 0.15 gallons per square foot, 6 liters per square meter, would add approximately 1.2.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.